Good evening and welcome to this Maundy Thursday evening service. Normally, of course, we'd be gathering in church, or actually the last few years, gathering in the centre to share food together, remembering the Last Supper. This year we can't do that in the same way, so we hope that wherever you are, you'll join with us in a very simple time of remembering, of prayer and of worship. For those of you that I may not have met before, my name is Nick Watson, I'm the rector from St Thomas's, and I'm here at home with Joanna and Thomas, who will be worshipping with us and helping doing the service. Now, to play a full part of the service, you might want to have some bread and some wine or another appropriate drink. We won't be blessing these as consecration like we would in a communion service. We can't do that in a service like this. But we can still use them in the way that, as we've heard, we'll hear, Jesus told us to remember him. You might also want to have handy a bowl of water and a small towel a bit later in the service. But if you want to simply sit and take part in the service in whatever way suits you, that's absolutely fine. You can see us, we can't see you. So please share in the service in whatever way most helps you. The words of the service are all in the booklet of the Three Great Days, which we hope those of you from St Thomas's have been able to get a copy of. If not, there is a link to the text of this service in the event notes for this service. But before we do anything else, let's be still. Is there anything that's on your heart and mind? Hand it over to God for a moment. If we're in church, then you would, of course, have made that journey, had that space in between whatever you've been doing and our gathering. So now, wherever you are, give yourself that space to be still. And we light three lights. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you.
And also with you.
In a moment's quiet, we open our hearts to God's Spirit, knowing that he is always around us and within us. And praying, Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ says, if you love me, keep my commandments. Unless I wash you, you have no part in me. Let us confess to Almighty God our sins against his love and ask him to cleanse us. Have mercy on us, O God, in your great goodness. According to the abundance of your compassion, blot out our offences. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Against you only have we sinned and done what is evil in your sight. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Purge us from our sin, and we shall be clean. Wash us, and we shall be whiter than snow. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Holy God, holy and strong, holy and immortal, have mercy upon us. May the Father forgive you by the death of his Son, and strengthen you to live in the power of the Spirit all our days. Amen. Amen. Let's pray that we may love one another as Christ has loved us. God our Father, your Son Jesus Christ was obedient to the end and drank the cup prepared for him. May we who share his table watch with him through the night of suffering and be faithful. Amen.
Amen. The first reading is taken from Paul's first letter to the Corinthians, chapter 11, beginning at verse 23. Beloved, I received from the Lord what I also handed on to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took a loaf of bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it, and said, "This is my body that is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he took the cup also after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Those words are actually the earliest account of the Last Supper. We often forget that because St. Paul's letters were written before the Gospels were written down. Of course, they drew on the same memories and same stories. But what it shows us is that from very early in the life of the Church, the first few years, Paul could take it for granted that the followers of Jesus knew the story of the Last Supper and were celebrating the Lord's Supper as part of their gathering and part of their worship. In fact, if you read the bits that come after that, you'll see that the Corinthians were actually getting it badly wrong in how they were celebrating. But they knew this was part of what it was to be a Christian, to meet with others, something that so many of us have been unable to do for so long now in our worship, to meet with others, to share food and drink with others, something else that seems, for many of us, a precious but distant memory. Perhaps, as we begin not only to worship together in church again, but to meet with others over food again in the coming months, we'll remember to see the meaning and the value in all of this in a way that perhaps we'd forgotten a bit. But on top of the vital, human, loving experience of sharing food and drink with others, that meal, that Last Supper, was the start of something that is unique. A meal whereby remembering Jesus, by sharing that remembrance, and by sharing the bread and the wine that recall what he did, we are in some way that we'll never fully understand, united with him and united with each other. Now, of course, that happens fully only to celebrate Holy Communion. But tonight, on this night when we remember the Last Supper, we're going to share bread and wine And if you're with others in the same household, then of course do share it amongst yourselves. But just as importantly, remember that all those of us who in these next minutes are going to share bread and then share wine, even if we're apart in distance, are united by one spirit, united by one remembering of Jesus, and united perhaps above all by his one sacrifice for us that we'll think about tomorrow. So for a moment, if you do have some bread, can I invite you just to look at it? And for a moment, remember the experience of sharing food with others, whether that's socially or spiritually. And then imagine that night when Jesus gathered his friends and they broke bread and shared it as he told them to remember him. And now in a moment's quiet, I invite you together or on your own, it's still part of this big church family, to remember Jesus and each other as we share bread. Jesus told his friends to share wine, a sign of his blood that we poured out for them, and to remember him. Over this last year, even when we have been able to celebrate communion, I know that I'm the only one who's been able to receive the wine. I've done that as your priest, on your behalf, and it's come to feel like a huge responsibility, because Jesus' blood is poured out for all of us. He commands all of us to share the cup. So this evening, if you have wine or something else to drink to help you to remember him, to remember that his blood was shed for you, take it now for a moment, give thanks for his love, his sacrifice, for the forgiveness that he's bought for you. And drink and remember. Let's give just a moment's silence. Lord Jesus, we remember you. And we rejoice that as we are joined with you in sharing bread and wine, we are joined with one another as your body, the church on earth. Draw us together until the day comes when we share this feast with you in the kingdom of heaven. Amen. influencing, and do please join in as much as you're able, depending on the neighbours. Saying, Lord Jesus Christ, you come to us, living Lord.
King of eternal glory. I give you a new commandment, says the Lord. Love one another as I have loved you.
Praise to you, O Christ, King of eternal glory.
Hear the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Now, before the festival of the Passover, Jesus knew that his hour had come to depart from this world and go to the Father. Having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. The devil had already put it into the heart of Judas, son of Simon Iscariot, to betray him. And during supper, Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into his hands, and that he had come from God and was going to God, got up from the table, took off his outer robe, and tied a towel around himself. Then he poured water into a basin, and began to wash the disciples' feet, and to wipe them with the towel that was tied around him. He came to Simon Peter, who said to him, Lord, are you going to wash my feet? Jesus answered, You do not know now what I am doing, but later you will understand. Peter said to him, You will never wash my feet. Jesus answered, Unless I wash you, you have no share with me. Simon Peter said to him, Lord, not my feet only, but also my hands and my head. Jesus said to him, One who has bathed and does not need to wash, except for the feet, but is entirely clean. And you are clean, though not all of you. For he knew who was to betray him, and for this reason he said, Not all of you are clean. After he had washed their feet, had put on his robes, and had returned to the table, he said to them, Do you know what I have done to you? You call me teacher and Lord, and you are right, for that is what I am. For so if I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet, for I have set you an example, and you also should do as I have done to you. Very truly I tell you, servants are not greater than their master, nor are messengers greater than the one who sent them. If you know these things, you are blessed if you do them. Now the Son of Man has been glorified, and God has been glorified in him. If God has been glorified in him, God will also glorify him in himself, and will glorify him at once. Little children, I am with you only a little longer. You will look for me, and as I said to the Jews, so now I say to you, where I am going, you cannot come. I give you a new commandment, that you love one another, just as I have loved you. You also should love one another. By this everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you love for one another. This is the Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ. Lord Jesus, inspire us with your love, to love in turn, and give us the humility to receive love and to receive service as well as giving it. Amen. Mm-hmm. The Last Supper was not only about giving us the Holy Communion. It was many things, there are many layers of symbolism in it. But it's also the chance for Jesus to give some of his most important teaching by word and example to his friends. In John's Gospel, then, several chapters are taken up with his words, and so many of them are about love and unity with each other, about humility, about trust in the Father, about the Spirit. There's a huge amount there when you try to pack into that last talk with his friends. But it began as they gathered at the table, and as perhaps they waited for someone to do the lowly work of washing the feet of the guests, Jesus did it himself. He gave them an example, an uncomfortable example, of what it means to live a life of love and service, to be prepared to do the things that need to be done for others, but also to be prepared to let others do them for and to you. Because the life of service to which Jesus calls us is not some kind of heroic, off on our own, self-sacrifice. It's a life of love and of care that goes both ways. Love that we receive and love that we give. It's as much a part of Christian discipleship to let others care for you as it is to care for them. Because in this way we all get the chance to live as Jesus taught us. It's strange that Sunday by Sunday we share bread and wine, now only usually in a very small token symbol, but we don't wash one another's feet. Perhaps if we're not going to bring that back into our regular weekly worship, we need to make doubly sure that when at the end of a service we go out back into the world, back into the rest of life, that's when we serve others. That's when we let others serve us. After all, that evening, Peter learned a hard lesson. He learned to let his master serve him. And that can be hard. So again, we're going to use a symbol. Just pass the bowl and the towel on the bottom of the table. Now again, if there are several of you in the house and you have got some water and a towel. And you might want to do this together and to do this for each other. If you are gathered together as a family or household, then I'm going to ask you in a moment, for simplicity, if you wash your own hands, but then dry each other's hands. Just a small token of what Jesus did that night. Just dip your hands in the water, wash them. But as you do that, whether you're on your own or with others, think of two things. Pray for the strength to serve others. And pray for the strength to let others, and above all, to let Jesus serve you. So in silence, we use water as a sign of service given and received. Carrying on that thought and that desire to serve. Let's pray.
In the power of the Spirit, let us pray to the Father through Christ, the Saviour of the world. The response to the prayer, Lord, hear us, is, and humble us. Lord, hear us. And humble us. Father, on this, the night he was betrayed, your Son, Jesus Christ, washed his disciples' feet. We commit ourselves to follow his example of love and service. Lord, hear us and humble us. On this night, he prayed for his disciples to be one. We pray for the unity of your church. Lord, hear us and unite us. On this night, he prayed for those who were to believe through his disciples' message. We pray for the mission of your church. Lord, hear us and renew our zeal. On this night, he commanded his disciples to love, but suffered rejection himself. We pray for the rejected and unloved. Lord, hear us and fill us with your love. On this night, he reminded his disciples that if the world hated them, it hated him first. We pray for those who are persecuted for their faith. Lord, hear us and give us your peace. On this night, he accepted the cup of death and looked forward to the new wine of the kingdom. We remember those who have died in the peace of Christ. Lord, hear us and welcome all your children into paradise.
A moment's quiet, we offer to God our own prayers. as our Saviour taught us, so we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Let's sing again. Disciples had sung a hymn. They went out to the Mount of Olives. Jesus prayed to the Father, "If it is possible, take this cup of suffering from me." He said to his disciples, "How is it that you are not able to keep watch with me for 1 hour? The hour has come for the Son of Man to be handed over to the power of sinful men. Come, let us go." Christ was obedient unto death. Go in his peace.